Good morning to all of you if you're here in Hong Kong, or good evening if you're in the United States, or if you're watching this later on our recording on YouTube. I don't know where you are, so I'll just say welcome. Today is Wednesday, December 3rd here in Hong Kong at the time we're going live with this, which means it's December 2nd there in the United States. But December 3rd here in Hong Kong is kind of crucial because that means we're 1 month from the US presidential election. 1 month and we still have a president who has not yet conceded, despite the fact that I see in the news today that most of those swing states have actually sent their certified results to the National Archives. Unfortunately, Wednesday in the US, Wednesday, December 2nd, also marked a milestone of another sort, 200,000 new cases of COVID-19 and 100,000 people hospitalized. We're gonna be talking about all of those things in this webinar today, which is called America Abroad, the Election, the Pandemic, Racial Injustice, and the US Through the Eyes of Foreign Correspondents. I'm Keith Richberg, I'm the director of HKU Journalism, and I'm really thrilled to be joined by a distinguished panel of journalists at this kind of key time. As I mentioned, the last 4 weeks, and in fact, the last 4 years, we could say, have been like none other in terms of newsworthiness, interest around the world, and fascination. We've had President Trump's America First foreign policy give us threats to withdraw from old alliances like NATO. We've seen a trade war with China. We've seen U.S. pull out of international agreements like the Iran nuclear agreement, the Paris Climate Agreement. As well as international organizations like WHO. And that's not even to mention the outcry over racial inequality that started in last May with the Black Lives Matter movement and the killing of George Floyd. So I think it's fair to say that America's global image has taken a bit of a hit, both in terms of as a country that was once a leader in technology and innovation, that people are now looking at why it's the leader in terms of COVID deaths and infections, and also its image as a beacon of democracy, where we see squabbling over the results and one side refusing to concede. So I'd love to hear the views of these foreign correspondents, how they view America or how they interpret America back for their audiences. I would invite everybody to put questions in the question box, in the chat box here, and we'll try to get to as many of those as we can as well. And I'm gonna do something a little bit different, which is instead of me standing here and introducing all of our guests, I'm gonna have them introduce themselves. And I'm gonna say, just tell us, I'll call on you. I'll just say, tell us who you are, what media outlet you're working for, how long you've been in the US, and just in a word or so, what's been your principal focus of your coverage over these last 4 months or this last year or so in the US? So I'm going to do it randomly too. Mark, let's start with you.
Oh, yeah. My name is Mark Pitzke, and I work for the German Newsweekly Der Spiegel. I've been with them for about 17 years. I'm based in New York City, right now in the home office in Brooklyn, because we had to close our main office in Manhattan. I've been in the US since 1993, actually. I went to school here and I sort of got stuck here, and I've been working as a correspondent since then in the US and living here. So for me, it's sort of like a double-edged sword. I'm not just an observer. I'm also somebody who lives here and has to deal with, the daily things that happen here. So the last 4 years were, of course, the main topic was Donald Trump and then the coronavirus. So we had our hands full. We're a whole team here. I'm not the only one. We're five correspondents right now. We were 12 for the elections that came over here. So.
Okay. Well, thanks. Well, moving on, Jiayan Fang. Tell the audience about yourself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Jiayan Fang. I'm a Washington, D.C. based reporter of BBC World Service. I first came to the United States 7 years ago as a student. I later stayed to work as a reporter. At one point, I was a colleague of Yan Zhang, who is also on the panel today, working for Hong Kong Initium Media. And now I report for BBC World Service in both English and Chinese on its TV, radio, and online platforms. For the past few months, no doubt the election was a big topic for my coverage, and also the US-China relations. And these topics and also the pandemic are really intertwined. I'm sure we will talk more about them later.
Mm-hmm. And you just did a nice little pitch or segue into Yanjiang up there in the corner from Initium. Tell us about yourself. Tell us about what Initium is and what you've been focusing on.
Thank you so much for having me here. I'm Yan. I'm the Washington correspondent with Initium Media, Duanchuan Mei. It is an independent digital magazine located in Hong Kong. And I think the readers in Asia are probably more familiar with it. I would say it's one of the few Chinese language media which is doing serious journalism and connecting the readers from mainland China, Hong Kong, Taiwan, and overseas, and also trying to fight censorship. And I used to report from mainland China for about 10 years and interpreted China stories to the outside world. And I moved to the United States in 2019, just last year. Currently, I live in DC, the capital, and I'm covering the presidential election, the subsequent events, the US-China relations, and also stories about the Chinese communities here. Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks for joining. And last but not least, an old friend of mine, Chris McGreal.
Hello, I'm a correspondent for The Guardian. I've been a foreign correspondent with them for about 30 years. Initially in Africa, where I met Keith, and then in the Middle East, and for the past 11 years in the United States. I was initially the Washington correspondent, but there's only so much Washington you can take, and there's a whole country out here. So I then started wandering around America, and I basically spent the past year and a half in the heartland, in the Midwest, focused very much on this election that we're talking about.
Great. Well, we're going to get back to you definitely and find out what's been going on in the heartland. But let me just start out generally first and just tell me if my opening construct of this webinar is correct. Has America's image taken a hit over the last 4 weeks because of this election, but also over the last 4 years? And do you see that as something kind of that can be restored now that we have a new president-elect coming in? Mark, can we start with you since you started first?
Yeah, sure. I mean, they've certainly taken a hit, of course. I mean, there's no doubt about this. But I think, especially with Europe and Germany, the transatlantic relations are so strong that it takes more than a Donald Trump to really break this apart. And we just had an interesting interview with Martin Schulz, who is a very prominent social democrat in Germany. He ran for the chancellery recently, unsuccessfully. And he said, you know, with Joe Biden now coming in, who is known as a transatlantic, you know, peacemaker, and he's very interested in, you know, international relations. We're looking again at, you know, more peaceful relations than we've had in the last 4 years, which doesn't mean that Europe and Germany says now, well, everything is back to normal, because, you know, I mean, the shock is still there. The shock of, you know, Trump going all alone and withdrawing from the Paris Accord and from the transatlantic trade accords. And so I think Europe has learned to be a little more confident. And also sort of learned the lessons that, you know, they have to be independent no matter who's in the White House, because, you know, Trump is not going away. I mean, he's going away as president, but he's not going to go away for a while. And we're going to deal with him and his 70 million, you know, voters for a while. So.
And there was some talk, Mark, that maybe, you know, this Trump kind of populist movement is not just isolated to the United States, but is in Europe as well. Is that accurate?
Well, you see that all over Europe. You see that, you know, in Hungary and everywhere. And so it's not, it's nothing that we shouldn't focus on Trump so much. It's easy. It's easy because his personality and you know, he's easy to write about. But there's more to it. And you know, Chris knows this very well from being in the heartland. There's something there that he touched a nerve that's been lying bare for a long time in the US. And he was the one who brought this all up. And you can't put that genie back into the bottle. And maybe you shouldn't. You have to deal with these people and their concerns, you know?
Yeah, we'll get back to that definitely. But Jiayan, I want to ask you, Mark just told us the transatlantic relationship is so strong that Trump may be seen as kind of an aberration. But what about the U.S.-China relationship? Because you report in Chinese and in English. I mean, is this going to go back to the way it was under the Obama years, or has the Trump years, has that created something new in the U.S.-China relationship?
Right. I think no one is naive enough to think we will go back to the Obama years now. Biden is about to be the president. Even though Biden is widely considered as one of the most experienced Western leaders in dealing with China, he actually spent a lot of time with Xi Jinping when they were both vice presidents of their countries. But as China's international influence has increased and its diplomacy has changed, I think Biden and his team's view on China has also changed. So a phrase I've heard a lot these days is competition without catastrophe, or competition without confrontation, to describe the future U.S.-China relations. Jake Sullivan, who was just nominated as the National Security Advisor, he co-wrote such a piece on U.S.-China relations, title, Competition Without Catastrophe. So I think that might be what the Biden administration is aiming for here. We need to compete with China, but we can try to outrun China without trying to slow China down, without trying to trip your opponent in this race. That's probably the strategy of his administration in terms of China.
Yeah, I'm glad you mentioned the Biden trip to Beijing when he and she were both vice president. I remember I covered that trip. Biden went to a tiny little restaurant near the Drum Tower to have dumplings, and he actually paid with cash out of his pockets. And everybody was so surprised that the vice president actually paid for his own meal and left a tip.
Well, that store has now benefited from Biden's victory. Hundreds of people lined up outside the store to try to have the vice president, now the U.S. president, combo that Biden once ordered.
They probably named a dumpling after him. Yin Zhang, you write for pretty much an audience in China, correct? Or a Chinese audience. So what's your view of how the image of the U.S. may have been shaken by over these last years, and what's going to happen now with the Biden presidency coming in?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question, because we are very well connected with the Chinese communities worldwide. And talking about the pandemic, the chaos during the election, and the nationwide demonstration really make a lot of people reconsider America's model, which they used to believe it is the best way to approach a better life. So I think many of them are more likely to compare the two systems, the two societies, the US and China, and they are quite confused now. And if you ask my readers, where would you like to live under the pandemic, the US or China, they may really have to think about it. So, back to your question, I don't think this is only about the image of the American democracy. It's actually about the image of the whole world we are living in. So for initium, we don't present it as an American issue. For example, the disputes between the left and right, the conservative and the progressive, and also the disinformation and misinformation. We think those are global issues, and it not only happens in the US, but also happens in many places around the world where people are experimenting with the democracy in their local communities. So for sure, the election, the pandemic are important lessons for all of us. And that is what we are trying to tell our readers, that this matters to you and you really need to care about it seriously. Yeah, and I hope that can answer your question, Keith.
Absolutely, yeah. And I'm going to bring Chris in. Chris, when we were setting this up, I think one of my colleagues said, but if you have Mark and Chris, you've got two Europeans. And I had to remind them, no, that there's now Brexit. So the UK is actually out of Europe now, but you're our cousins from across the pond. And so you're supposed to be, know us better, or our democracies are similar. But how have you seen what's been happening over the last few years and interpreting that back to your readers at The Guardian?
Yeah, well, I'd point out we are still Europeans, but just
barely.
But the British are absolutely fascinated with America and always will be. And I think from governments aside, from a British public point of view, Trump is the, you know, they thought, to be honest, they thought that George W. Bush was the worst president in American history. And now they've revised that assessment and concluded that it's Trump. And there's a fascination with him. I think that, I spend quite a lot of time trying to explain to people in Britain why people might vote for Trump beyond the reasons that people think that they voted for Trump. And that obviously requires talking quite a lot about, you know, the complexities of America, everything from the realities of the economic system here, which compared to Europe, you know, leaves a lot of people behind, very few social protections, healthcare is a disaster, through to the American value system, which is just simply very, very different to European value system. It straightforwardly, this is not a social democratic country. And I think often people in Britain, you know, struggle with what that means and the nature of individualism here. And a lot of that has kind of manifested itself through Trump, because really Trump just said a lot of things that politicians think and people think, but presidents weren't expected to say. And he simply said them. And that's part of his appeal. I think that this year has been particularly peculiar because of his handling of coronavirus. The handling hasn't been particularly good in Britain, and actually the death rates per capita are quite similar between the US and the UK, but just his denialism, his pushing of a quack cures, his criticizing his own scientists live in press conferences. Again, I think it makes him a unique president. And I think on the whole, people in the UK have kind of reeled in horror, I would say. And I tried to explain to them perhaps why it's not as bad as it might look to them.
And Chris, let's stay with you just for a moment here. Because you had Brexit before we had Trump, and then Boris Johnson was on the scene. I mean, did the Britons kind of see Trump coming before the Americans press did? Or
I don't necessarily think so. I think that certainly it was very interesting watching the British press, which didn't see Brexit coming in the same way that the American press didn't see Trump coming. They, in both cases, they assumed the Trump Brexit camps would lose. And once the British press started to deconstruct why Brexit won, actually you started to see them discover the same things that the Americans press would discover slightly later about why Trump won. Which really are, you know, people who feel economically dislocated, nobody really speaks for them, they don't have much hope. And in both cases, of course, it was easy to offer simplistic solutions and to pick on people who really weren't to blame for people's problems, but were easy targets. So I don't necessarily think that the British press saw Trump coming in that same way, but once he did come, they started to see the parallels.
That's really interesting. Mark, I'm going to come to you for a second. When we spoke earlier, before this meeting, you were telling us how you've covered campaigns before, and you were kind of planning on this one being a typical or classic campaign, but now you're having to kind of question a lot of assumptions. And you know America as much as anybody since you've been there since 94, since probably high school, right? tell us what's changed in your view.
Well, you know, as I said before, this you get into a campaign rhythm and it gets very repetitive. You know, you have the primaries, you have the caucuses, and you have to the conventions and the debates and all that. And we were getting ready for something like that, but then of course Trump won the primaries and he started messing everything up already there, and you knew something was up, and you knew this is going to be different. What we didn't know, of course, was then when the pandemic hit, how this campaign, nobody knew how this was going to go. Everybody figured it out as they went day by day. I remember my last campaign trip this year was the primaries in South Carolina and at the end of February, and then everything shut down in the beginning of March, and we were thinking, how are we going to do this? How are we going to tell the story of America and the story of the people in America if we can't get there? And if, you know, I sit in New York and we have people in San Francisco and in Washington, D.C., but that's not enough. That's exactly the places where you don't want to be to cover a campaign. So it took a couple of weeks, actually a couple of months until we got back on the road very carefully, you know, and very gingerly. And I think my first trip out was in June, the funeral of George Floyd, which was not a campaign trip, but, you know, it was a big topic and a big, big story. And it's still a big story today. So this was all new for me. I've, you know, and I got a little jaded, and I appreciate that this was all new for me. And I, as a journalist, you know, when you think you know everything, then that's, you know, that's the end for you. You should really learn every day. And this was a big learning experience for me, which I'm very, you know, happy that I went through it in the end.
Sure. And Jiayan, I want to ask you, because you've been in the US for a long time too. And one of the things that I've seen from here in Hong Kong was this kind of like nasty anti-Asian sentiment that grew up. A lot of hate crimes have been reported now since the virus, but even before, when President Trump was starting his trade war, et cetera. How was it being a Chinese journalist in the US, but reporting for BBC? I mean, how can you describe that a little bit for us?
Yeah, it's indeed a very tricky identity as a Chinese reporter working for the BBC in the US. I would say I used to see my Chinese identity as an advantage as a foreign correspondent in the US, for example, especially when I ask questions to the ordinary American people. Like I would say, oh, you know, I'm new to this country, I'm a foreigner, I'm from a non-democratic country, I have no idea how this works, please educate me. And that used to be a big advantage. But in the recent years, the Chinese identity has definitely become more like a disadvantage, especially in Washington, D.C. I could sense heightened suspicions towards Chinese reporters, not only myself, and also there's a new visa rule targeting all Chinese nationals holding a foreign reporter visa in the U.S. The visa period, stay period, is limited to 90 days, and that's targeting all Chinese nationals, no matter who you work for, what kind of reporting you do. This poses an important question, like if outlets like The Guardian, The Spiegel, or Reuters, The Economist, cannot hire Chinese nationals and secure them a steady long-term visa in the US, is this an alarming sign for press freedom in America during the Trump era, especially for Chinese reporters who already cannot report freely in their home country? A lot of them are coming to the US for greater press freedom. And in a time that China story has become more important and global, this might be a question for a lot of global newsroom to think of, whether they want to involve more Chinese national when they cover global China stories. These people can provide the right context and the language and culture expertise in their coverage. But we're not seeing that much representation of Chinese reporters in global newsroom, not even in news bonanza like the US right now.
Yeah. And are you affected personally by the 90-day visa rule now?
Yeah, I'm also affected. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. And well, do you have any indication that the Biden administration might change that rule and go back to the way it was before? Or have you heard anything?
Well, I don't know about this visa rule in particular, but it seems like China might not be the priority for Biden in the first 100 days. And in fact, he might even consider, you know, take over some of Trump's China policy, even though he might not like them, because this can become a leverage for him in his later China policy building. So I'm not very hopeful that, you know, the day after his inauguration, I would have a longer visa. I guess we'll wait and see. Probably Biden will have a completely different China strategy in terms of how to treat Chinese students and reporters and diplomats.
Or he might just have a strategy. which I don't think the previous administration had, right? Yan Zhang, you spent a lot of time speaking to the Chinese diaspora, the Chinese American community as well, right? What have you learned about them, and what have you learned about how they view America and how they have viewed the Trump years?
Well, it's a great question. I mean, any topics related to Chinese communities and the Trump years are very popular among our readers because it's their own story, and they hope it can be well explained to the outside world. And I can give you one example. I interviewed some Chinese American voters to see if they were offended by Trump saying China virus. And what surprised me was they were not, because they actually welcome this rhetoric and they voted for Trump because of this. And many of them are the first generation of immigrants. They moved to the US in 1990s or early 2000, and after so many years of struggling with who they are, they just decided to cut off the relations with their home country and to embrace America. So it's kind of tricky, and they convinced themselves that they are Americans, not Chinese, not Chinese Americans, not Asian Americans, just Americans. And their home country, China, has been an imaginary place which is not well organized, not even civilized. That is a place where the virus came from, which can prove their life choice is right. And that is how they make peace with who they are, which is based on the self-convincing, I would say. So I'm not going to say this is right or wrong. I just find it's part of the human nature, and I cannot really judge them. I find it so true and so brutal.
Can I stay with you for a minute, Yan Zhang? I'm just kind of curious, you know, the in Hong Kong here, there have been pro-democracy types who have been really upset about Biden's victory because they think that he's not going to be as tough as President Trump. And if you look at Weibo in China, there are a lot of people who are actually very pro-Trump, which is surprisingly so. I mean, what accounts for this?
Yeah, I would say people's opinion towards Trump are so divided. For example, many Chinese readers, especially those are from a non-democratic society, are more interested in Trump's character, personality, and the power Trump has as a president. They like the juicy part of Trump, who spilled a lot of stuff on Twitter, and those people are very obsessed to see if the president can make the market rise or make it fall, or if he can make YouTube war or bring peace. And in the meantime, I would say they show less interest in which kind of democratic or judiciary system the president of the United States has to follow and respect. And also talking about the readers from Hong Kong or Taiwan, I would say many readers from Taiwan are very supportive of Trump's foreign policy, simply because they are so eager for Taiwan to have a more international attention and dignity. So when I published the story that Biden won the election, they didn't believe me. They didn't believe us. They call us fake news on social media. But to be honest, are they really in favor of Trump? I doubt that. It's true that there are some convergence of their interest and Trump's policy, but it doesn't mean that they are 100% Trump supporters. There are a lot of debates within their community, and I believe that should be very well understood instead of a simple conclusion that if people view Trump as a hero or as a clown. Yeah.
Jiayan, can you add to that? I see you nodding your head in agreement there.
Yeah, surprisingly, Hong Kong and Taiwan are the two largest base for Trump in Asia. And even in China, there are supporters of Trump as well, but for different reasons. Many see Trump will undermine the US, and that will be beneficial for China's rise. So people are watching a political soap opera. While among Chinese liberals, there is also a very strong support for Trump. I think that's fascinating. For example, the exiled Chinese activist Cheng Guangcheng, he was one of the speakers on the RNC supporting Trump's presidency. And a friend of mine, Lin Yao, wrote a paper to explain this phenomenon of Chinese liberal embracing American conservatism. He called it beacon complex. Chinese liberals were traumatized by the regime in China. So they immediately embrace the American conservative belief, the small government, and they hold America as the beacon of liberty and freedoms and democracy. So they worship Trump. And I wonder this phenomenon, how it will continue after Trump's presidency. We always say Trumpism continues, lives on, and how this will change the Chinese liberals believe in democratic system.
Mark, let me ask you a similar question. I mean, we assume everybody can't wait to see the backside of Trump, but are there any people in Germany or indeed in Europe who actually think he did a good thing and are saying, wow, this guy actually did some things that needed to be done? Or is that not the case in Germany or Europe, right, wider?
Well, of course there are. I assume that. I don't want to speak for all Europe, and I certainly also can't speak for all Germany because it's all anecdotal. I know from the mail we get a lot of feedback from our readers, and it's very polarized. It's very much like it's here. It's most of it is anti-Trump, but there's a few people also who support his policies, who support the toughness, and you know, finally he's saying something. And you know, this goes to something what was said earlier, that you know, the forgotten people, as they call them, you know, that somebody finally spoke to those people who are falling through the cracks, and they still are. And that's something that resonates in Germany certainly too. And you see, you have the AfD, you have a right-wing movement in Germany that is not as strong as maybe the Republicans here, but the feeling is there, definitely. And also I feel, on the other hand, that Trump violates so many principles that Germans hold dear. And we talked about this earlier too. You know, you have the American individualism. In Germany, we have what we call the Solidaritätsprinzip. That means we have a solidarity in society where we support each other. You know, we have a social net, it's a safety net. We, you know, we have health insurance that kind of works. At least it works better than here. And Trump, with his narcissism and his political narcissism in a way, was the antidote to this. And I think a lot of Germans were very offended by this and still are. So I think that a lot of people are looking for a different tone, but not necessarily different policies. So I think in any case, we have he resonates in Germany with fewer people than here, but he definitely does too. Yeah.
And Chris, let me ask you, because Boris Johnson was seen as Trump's best friend on the other side of the Atlantic, but not, and Nigel Farage, I suppose. But I mean, is that are there others there in the UK, you think? I mean, I know you're in the US, but I mean, among your readers, are there some people who actually think that Trump is not a bad guy, or that he did some good things?
Oh yeah, I mean, certainly Boris Johnson is going to be sorry to see Trump go. Partly because it's quite clear that there's quite a sour relationship between Johnson and Biden because of the way Johnson spoke about Obama in neo-colonial terms. So, and Biden hasn't forgotten that. So there's that for a start. But yeah, I mean, I think some of what you see, and to be honest, you see it around coronavirus and the lockdown, that pushback that you get in America. You've got maybe not to the same extent in Britain, but you know, the government shouldn't be telling us what to do. That resistance of having to obey the lockdown or the social distancing. And I think Trump appealed to a section of the population because he was seen as, you know, for whatever his background, he projected himself as standing up against elites, against the swamp, the way things are. And there's certainly a section of the British public, that part of which voted for Brexit on these lines, had grown tired of British governments they saw as elitist, whether it was Tony Blair's Labour Party, David Cameron's Conservatives, you know, these were all posh boys from public schools or private schools. the kind of leaders that I think in America used to be regarded as country club Republicans, like George W. Bush, they've been replaced with, you know, Trump, who is definitely not a country club Republican. And I think that has a lot of appeal to some people in Britain. They feel that Brexit in part was overturning that type of leadership, and they like him upending things. Yeah, that certainly has appeal.
And Mark used a great phrase when he said that Trump was appealing to the people who had fallen between the cracks. And you basically moved out to one of the cracks out there in Kansas. So, I mean, we in the media, we have this image of the Trump voter as kind of, you know, maybe mildly racist, they don't want immigrants in, et cetera. But what, tell us what you've learned living in red America.
Well, I mean, as you would expect, there are lots of reasons that people voted for Trump. And, one of the things about, a whole section of the Midwest, which I made a point of going to, swing counties, twice voted for Obama and then voted for Trump. And one of the things that's really interesting is that the majority of those counties this time voted for Trump even more. So when people turn around and say, well, they're just racist, that's why they vote for Trump, you have to overcome the problem that, yeah, but they voted for Obama twice. So that isn't the whole explanation or even the explanation at all. And what's this about? And it's quite, I think at the bottom of it is a sense of being left behind, that the Democratic Party no longer represents their interests, no longer speaks to them, for them, doesn't really even bother. I mean, even this election campaign, even though Trump, even though Biden, managed to pull it off in the upper Midwest, really you didn't see Biden or the Democrats in any way embraced in this part of the world. I think Biden took those swing states, Wisconsin, Michigan, because people didn't like Trump, and they were prepared to vote for Biden when they hadn't been prepared to vote for Hillary Clinton. But the idea that the Democrats have any real appeal out here outside of the cities, I think is, the reason that Trump won in the first place. There's just a sense of alienation. No sense, I think, out here that Democratic policies address their problems. I think that is probably the biggest. Now, all these other factors you mentioned, racism, dislike of immigrants, all of that played a big part, as did, we were talking about China and Trump earlier, as did China and trade. I mean, that was a big plus for Trump out here. It's not clear he achieved very much in going into a trade war with China or with sanctions. But what he did do was look like he was standing up to China, to people out here. And they welcomed that. That was a big plus for him, particularly in mining communities in places like Minnesota.
And Chris, may I keep you on just for a moment longer? Because you wrote a book about the opioid epidemic. And just take a minute and just describe that problem in the U.S., because I don't think people outside the U.S. know how big of an issue that is.
Yeah, I mean, it was a shock to me when I started researching the book. I mean, you have in this country somewhere around 600,000 people who've died of opioid overdoses over the past two decades. And it began with prescription opioids, painkillers, that were essentially pushed by the manufacturers as a kind of a magic bullet against pain. And they just got pushed out there, very high strength opioids. And two things really happened. One is a ton of people who should never have been prescribed them in the first place became addicted. And then word spread that they were an easy and legal way to get high. And they became a substitute for other drugs like methamphetamine. And they really took a hold, particularly in Appalachia, those poorer parts of the United States that we've been talking about that have been a bit left behind, but also particularly kind of manual labor communities where you had a lot of physical labor. And so these drugs were likely to be prescribed. And it's perhaps quite revealing that, these were very conservative communities, a lot of them. And they have come to regard the pharmaceutical industry in this company, in this country, as little different to the Mexican drug cartels, that they were just pushing very powerful drugs to get rich. And it's had an incredible cost, not just in lives, but in the social deprivation, the destruction of communities. and children left behind.
Absolutely fascinating. Again, that's a story I don't think outside the US people appreciate as much. And let me just slightly shift topics a bit. I want to talk a bit about the coronavirus pandemic and the US response to it, the number of deaths, and the way the rest of the world is doing. Who can I pick on now? Yin Zhang, can I start with you for one moment? Looking at China, China is where a lot of people believe the virus started in Wuhan, although there's some indications it might have been floating around earlier. But, we all looked at the horror stories of Wuhan in January, February of last year. But now China seems fine. I mean, the number of cases is down. They're kind of back to normal. And in fact, they had a big pool party in Wuhan. As a Chinese looking at this, but also among your readers and people you talk to in China, are they saying, wow, we know how to do this and America is really just off their game? They don't have not a clue what they're doing, or they're not willing to take the tough measures? I mean, how would people view what's happened in China versus what's happened in the US in regards to the virus?
Well, I think I will have a pretty similar response to the other question you just mentioned before. Will the election really damage the image of America? I think the pandemic has really different scenarios in the US and in China. So at the very beginning of this year, and when there was an outbreak in Wuhan, later in China, people here are talking about the possible cooperation or at least exchange of information between the two countries. For one thing, China may be a little bit more open on this issue, and the US may have a chance to send experts on the ground to gather first-hand information and share with the world. That's what people were eager to see, but unfortunately it didn't happen. And back to that moment, I heard people in Washington criticize China's political system, which is, as they said, lack of transparency, and ended up such a big problem to the world. So when the US found the first few cases, I felt a very strong confidence from the US government that they can handle it properly because they believe their system has more advantages, more transparency. But unfortunately, it didn't happen either. So if you ask me about how to look at America's response to the pandemic or even compare it with China, I think we just confused, really confused about what is going on and how did we end up here. And I can think about it more, yeah.
Well, we are all confused about it, and Zhao Yingfeng is gonna explain to us why the US bungled its response to coronavirus, but some of the countries in Asia, including Taiwan, have done fairly well.
Yeah, well, thinking of covering the pandemic for the past few months, and I really started covering the Wuhan outbreak while I was based in Washington in early January since then. And I vividly remember a press conference in the Rose Garden in the White House in early March, in which Trump announced a national emergency over COVID-19. Over 200 reporters and officials were there. And I was one of the only two reporters wearing a mask. The other reporter was also Chinese. And we were anxious because we were afraid that our mask will be seen as a political statement. And now in hindsight, thinking of it, it was ridiculous that a health choice may be interpreted as a political gesture in the US. And I also remember in the early days of the US pandemic, seeing signs in DC saying, oh, if you travel to China in the past 14 days, don't step in. But it wasn't a foreign virus, though the Trump administration certainly tried to phrase it as the China virus. At that point, it was already clear that there was a virus spreading in communities in Washington state and other parts of the US. But at that time, most people still see it as a foreign problem. And I sometimes ask myself as a journalist, did we do anything wrong covering the initial outbreak in Wuhan? How could we better communicate a story so readers outside of China could better feel the pain of Chinese people suffering from a pandemic. Maybe that would serve as a warning to them, and they would see the pandemic as a common threat rather than the Chinese government messing up with an easy virus. So I guess that's what keeps me awake sometime at night.
Yeah, and Mark, you mentioned earlier, you've been in the United States a long time. You mentioned earlier that, you know, you understand Americans have this kind of more feeling about individual freedoms. I mean, did you expect the virus would go this direction when it first kind of came in the U.S. at the end of February in Washington State?
No, I don't think anybody here expected it. But, you know, we had a slightly different situation here in New York. We were watching what, you know, what she just said about the press conference in the Rose Garden and the whole behavior in Washington, D.C. And New York shut down pretty soon with our governor, who didn't do everything right, but he did do a lot of things right. And we went through this first big wave here in March and April. And I have to tell you, it was one of the scariest things I've experienced as a person. I've been here in New York for 9/11. I've been here for Hurricane Sandy. I've seen the city go through a lot of hardship. And this was probably the toughest time I've ever experienced here. And then you think, well, the other states, the other Americans, the rest of the country, don't you learn the lesson from watching us go through this? Don't you see what this can do? Don't you see the freezer trucks in front of the hospitals? Don't you want this not to happen in your state? And well, we see what, it's still happening. It's still, you know, the whole wave went over, it went to the south, it went to Florida, to the southern states. Now it's in the Midwest, in North Dakota, South Dakota. And it seems like people have to learn the same lesson over and over and over again. And it is a political statement when you wear a mask in many parts of this country. And I think it's just, I think the main reason for that is not just individualism, but the utter lack of leadership, national leadership. Now, Germany has had, you know, much better numbers, but they're now going into their second lockdown. They just extended the partial shutdown until January 10th today. And the whole country goes along with it. You know, you have people who, you know, disagree and who, you know, you had rallies against the masks and the same thing you see here, but not as much as here. Here you still have this whole scattered approach, and the person at the very top doesn't care. And first we all thought, well, it's just a political thing for him. He doesn't want to lose the election. That's why he's ignoring this. That's why he's playing it down. But the elections are over and he still doesn't care. It's still not a word. All he talks about is, you know, the election fraud that he makes up. So I don't think anything is going to happen until, you know, the next administration comes in and sets an example and sets a new tone for people to really, it's gonna be a tough winter in the whole country. And the CDC said this today, it's probably gonna be the toughest 3 months health-wise in the entire history of this country. And, you know, that's a political story. It's a really political, it's a disaster what happened here politically. And I think the real reasons for that will slowly come out over time. We're still in it. We're still in it. I mean, we just had a debate in my household whether to go to a Christmas party in a couple of weeks here in Brooklyn. I mean, I'm not going. I don't want to go to that. But there's people who said, well, we haven't seen our families. We want to go. Look at the people who traveled over Thanksgiving. Millions and millions of America crowding the airports. So what can you say?
Yeah. I mean, it's funny. Yeah, the U.S. had the advantage of looking at Asia, but did not really get prepared for it. Chris, where you are, middle America, Kansas, had the advantage of looking at New York and looking at New Jersey and saying, wow, we better get ready for this thing. We know this thing is bad. But what happened?
What happened was their economies. They looked at New York and what was happening. but saw their own economies being shut down, people being thrown out of jobs, but they weren't being affected. And they were saying, why is this happening to us when it's New York's problem? I mean, I can look out my window of my apartment here and I can pick off all the bars and restaurants that have just gone out of business here. You know, they're just shut completely. You can walk down the street and they're everywhere in Kansas City. And I think there was a real feeling that, yeah, this is a crisis in New York. And when there's a crisis in New York, we have to pay the price. When there's a crisis here, New York just ignores us. Opioids being an example, actually, if you go to West Virginia and Eastern Kentucky, the center of these opioid epidemics, they'll tell you this happened to us because we're poor and the elites don't pay any attention to us. You know, if it hit New York, they'd have done something about prescription opioids. And I think there was a real sense here that this is somebody else's problem and we're being thrown out of our jobs. So by the time that, as Mark said, you know, that thing left New York and it reached the Midwest, actually people had come around to the idea that the cure was worse than the disease, that shutting down the economy, losing your job really wasn't worth it. Yes, some people die, but, and you know, there was the fake news, there was the false comparisons with your average flu year that took hold. But I think that because they weren't part of the first wave, people actually did initially go along around here with those measures. They, you know, the bars were closed, the people did wear masks, they just grew weary of it and couldn't see the benefit whilst they were losing their jobs. And I think that had a big impact. And then, as Mark said, you didn't have the leadership. You didn't have Trump explaining why we might need to do this. He played on that division, he undermined the science. He wouldn't even wear a mask himself, you know. So then, of course, anybody that doesn't want to has got a perfect excuse not.
Chris, the Brits have beaten the world in approving a vaccine now. So you've beaten the Americans at their own game, I guess.
Yes, although that's partly because the regulatory process is slightly different in that the FDA goes back through all the data and the Brits go, yeah, well, that looks all right to us. And here you go. We will see. I mean, they'll be giving it in Britain to medical staff first. So if the medical staff all start falling over, we'll know what's happened.
Okay, well, we'll see. It's gonna be a real race around the world to see who gets it out first and then who delivers it around the world, because it's all the goodwill. I think China is already planning on delivering it to African countries and other places. It's gonna be fascinating to watch. I would be remiss if I did not bring up at least in passing here, the protest over racial inequality, the killing of George Floyd. This thing went around the world in ways that surprised me, shocked me, et cetera. I'll just go around. Let's start with Jiayin Feng. Where were you when the George Floyd protests all started? And did you cover that? And how did you cover that for your international and especially Chinese speaking audiences?
I certainly covered that. I was in DC. And it was surreal here because for days, protests went on during the night. And you could hear helicopters and just sirens running in the wee hours. I cover it, but probably not surprisingly, we got a lot of pushback from Chinese readers. We're talking about readers living in the United States or in Taiwan and Hong Kong, Chinese readers. And they had a lot of doubts about the movement. And a part of it is China is a very homogeneous society. They're not used to having Black friends or even having a discussion about racial justice. And for those Chinese immigrants living in America, they often felt left out in such a conversation. Like the American racial conversation is seen as Black versus white in their eyes. And many Asian Americans, although they join in such a discussion after they experience the anti-Asian discrimination during the pandemic, but still a lot of them are not on board yet, especially immigrants from mainland China. For a lot of them, they feel unfair that they are grouped together as the minorities. They don't feel the tag of Asian Americans or, you know, minority really define their identity. And they felt left out and became scapegoat in this racial discussion, especially the issue of affirmative actions. Many Chinese immigrants see that this is of disadvantage to their children who were born and raised in America.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, who's yet? Yan Zhang. The George Floyd killing, racial injustice. I mean, that was that a story that gained traction among your initial audience in China?
Oh, yes, for sure. Especially there's readers from Hong Kong. They are actually very concerned about the police brutality in the US, the use of force by the law enforcement, because that recalls their memory of last year, what happened in Hong Kong. It's kind of interesting that last year when Hong Kong had a protest, a large scale protest, when my colleagues were reporting on the ground and eating tear gas on the street, I was sitting in a fancy office and living a relatively peaceful life, and I felt kind of guilty. And now this year, my colleague texted me that, hey, it's your turn. And I actually watched a lot of violence and police brutality on the street of DC. And but what I'm trying to say that there are some voices from Hong Kong who strongly disagree to compare the Black Lives Matter movement with Hong Kong protest, because the demonstration in Hong Kong didn't turn out to be looting or riots. And that's for one thing. And the other thing is the Hong Kong government didn't really respond to the appeals of the protesters, but the US government did. You saw the high level US officials, the people in Congress, they responded to the movement. They made speeches, they even joined the protest. So that is very different from Hong Kong. So we have a lot of discussion about it. And I would say the movement here with the protest here really encourage our readers to discuss, to rethink about what they have been experienced in Hong Kong and what are they going to do. And I even know some of our readers who are Chinese students here or Hong Kong students or some young Chinese Americans, they took on the street to attend the protest to show their support to African American and other minorities in this society. Yeah, I'll stop here.
That's fascinating. And Mark, I'm going to put you on the spot for a second. Now, you've been in the US since 94, so you know the place very well. You've obviously been hearing these stories of police treatment of African Americans for a long time, but were you surprised by this outpouring that spread all the way to Germany? There were Black Lives Matter protests in Germany after the George Floyd killing.
That's a very good point. I asked myself that question too. Why now? Why? I was in Ferguson, and when was this, 2014, when Michael Brown was shot. We've covered these, police cases of police brutality and racism and white supremacy. We've covered these over the years. We've had many cover stories. It's been one of the most read stories and topics that we've had over the years for our German readers. But why did the spark go off this time? And I'm married to an African American, so we've had these discussions over and over and over again. And I can only learn as a white person about my white privilege and about why I don't see these things that they see, and I can't see these things that they see. I think this time it was a combination of reasons. It was the pandemic. Everybody was at home. Nobody was working. There was a lot of pent up anger. There was a lot of frustration with politics in general and with the whole, behavior of Trump, think about Charlottesville and all this. I think all this came together and just exploded. And I remember, here in Brooklyn, they had every single night, they were marching down the street, down my block, across the Brooklyn Bridge to Manhattan every single night. And it was a different crowd than before. It was younger people. It was a lot of white people, a lot of students. So the solidarity that came together there was really extraordinary. And it's still going on, not that much anymore, because, you know, people have, you know, can't rally every night. But this was really a really remarkable thing to see for me too, after all these years. And like I said, I went to George Floyd's funeral, which was in Houston. And I met families that came with three generations, with the grandparents, with the parents, and with the little kid, to show them at the open casket what this is about. It reminded me of Emmett Till, you know, who was the teenager who was killed way back in the 50s, who sparked the civil rights, beginning of the civil rights movement back then. They also had an open casket because his mother insisted on it, because she said, "I want the world to see what they did to my child." And I think the fact that George Floyd's death was on video for the whole world to see, all those 9 minutes, and all these other things that I mentioned before, just led to this really amazing movement.
Let me bring Chris in here for a minute, because you were in middle America there. How did the George Floyd movement and the death and the protests resonate in that part of the country? Was it as much as on the East Coast, where our other speakers are from? And then separately, did you see any kind of a backlash against the protests?
I went to Minneapolis the day after it happened and was there through the protests. And that was very instructive, because the protests kind of got boiled down into kind of simplistic generalizations about what they were. And there were distinct protests, separate violent protests from the daily demonstrations, which were perfectly peaceful, and different motives for why people were out. So being on the ground in Minneapolis was very instructive. And also about who turned up to protest. You know, there were people there who primary interest was not the issue around Black Lives Matter. That was a vehicle for them. Anti-capitalist protests, for instance. For me, the thing that was decisive in making this one different was that 8 minutes and 45 seconds of George Floyd on the ground. I think, you know, I was in Ferguson as well, and, you know, that shooting was up for interpretation depending on who you were, and lots of people chose to believe the police. I think the thing about the George Floyd video was it was there. There was no interpretation except what you saw with your own eyes. And I think it was very striking to me that even in this part of the world, which, you know, naturally adheres to the police line, shall we say, there were plenty of people, Republicans, saying this is outright murder. I heard it from Republican county chairs in places like Iowa and Wisconsin. They were just saying, you know, the police killed him. There's no doubt about it. That this was murder. This was unjustified. Something needs to change. And you saw that reflected in the opinion polls. The opinion polls in those first kind of few weeks showed that about two-thirds of Americans were pretty firmly behind what they perceived Black Lives Matter as standing for, which was reform of the police. But then things start to change. And I think the two big changes were, one, the continuing violence. You saw another wave in Portland in August, September, which I went to. And then I think, and I know this is up for dispute, but in this part of the world, the slogan defund the police had a really bad impact, because you can sit around and debate what was meant by that as much as you like. And because Obama has just criticized the use of defund the police, that debate is now taking place. But the reality out here was it was interpreted as get rid of the police, or, you know, take away most of their money. And it was a really bad, from a political point of view, it was a really bad slogan that played into the hands of those who were opposed to Black Lives Matter. It was very unsophisticated. And, you know, one of the things that, if you go back to Minneapolis, which I have been, and you talk to Black communities there, they feel the diminishment of the police wasn't the answer. They they have a crime problem and they want the police. They just want the police to behave differently. They want less police, you know. Yeah. So, yeah, it was a movement that had real potential and I think still does, but it certainly lost some momentum in this part of the world.
Okay. Go ahead.
Second question. I can't remember what second part of your question was, but anyway.
Oh, no, I was just asking. You answered that. I asked, was there a backlash to it? So, yeah.
Oh, yeah, there definitely was.
I'm going to have a wrap-up question, but I do want to just toss out a couple of audience questions that I've been kind of monitoring the box here. I'll just go ahead and decide who's going to answer which. And I'm going to pick on Jiayan first. This question comes from one of the audience members who asked, with Biden about to enter the White House, what are the implications for Hong Kong relations after that?
Well, if we're talking about China-Hong Kong relations, I doubt there will be a big difference. I think we've seen enough that no matter how much international pressure was applied on Beijing, it hardly shifts Beijing's decisions on Hong Kong issues. Probably Beijing was seeing the US administration BC grappling with other issues. So it was emboldened by that. But fundamentally, I don't see Beijing would consider the US foreign policy or the US will on Hong Kong as an important element in its decision making. Maybe Yan would have a different opinion.
A difference of opinion, perhaps. Yan Zhang. How will China Hong Kong relations be after the Biden administration comes in? Yeah.
Actually, I'm currently working on a story about Biden's foreign policy, and
give us the scoop.
Yeah, it's very hard to say what is Biden going to do on Hong Kong, but what is obvious is Hong Kong, for US, Hong Kong is part of China issue. So how to deal with Hong Kong is basically according to how the US will deal with China. So what I heard in Washington is Biden may inherit some elements from Trump's policy, which he finds useful or may use them as leverage as necessary, even though he doesn't agree with them. For example, the tariff, Biden may not leave the tariffs until he sees something is returned or provided by Beijing, and also the Hong Kong issue, because it's really got the bipartisan support. And there's no doubt that Biden administration will pay more attention to the human rights issue, and Hong Kong is part of it. And also, I would like to say it's not only about how Biden's foreign policy will be different from Trump. That's what our Hong Kong readers are really concerned about. For example, they asked us if Biden will be really soft or even weak on China. But I don't think that's true. But also we have to look at how different it will be from Obama. I think we all agree that some fundamental things for US-China relations have changed in the past few years. For the US, people don't believe, cooperation will lead to a more cooperative China. This kind of logic, people don't believe that anymore, you know? So I think they learned a lesson. I mean, the US government learned a lesson and they are trying to find a more practical way to deal with it. So if you look at Biden's cabinet, where I heard from DC is that, for example, Sullivan or Blinken, they are distant, rational, and professional diplomats. And let's hope there could be a breakthrough for the two countries' relationship rather than the retaliation or dispute sort of things. And but I have to say it's not only depends on American, but also on China. How will China react to the new government? If China will take advantage and be more aggressive at this moment when Biden focuses on fighting the pandemic and other domestic concerns. And here in DC, I think people are also talking about how to rebuild Americans' confidence. You cannot keep watching what China is doing and then make up your foreign policy. And also you cannot just make something called strategic strategy. I mean, when foreign policymakers put this kind of word strategic before a noun, it usually means they are not quite sure what they are going for. So you need to be more specific, more practical, and people believe there will be a change in Biden's administration. Yeah.
And while you're there, Yanjiang, John Burns in our audience is asking, what about the sanctions on Hong Kong's leaders and the security folks? Do you have any sense of Biden's views on whether that would continue? Carrie Lam didn't use her credit cards.
Yeah, like what I just said, I think Biden may not, it's not what I think. According to my interviews with people here, Biden may inherit some elements from Trump's policy. For example, the sanctions is already on the table. So let's negotiate, let's talk about it. And he may make a change until to see Hong Kong or Beijing, give something as a return or provide something new. Yeah.
Okay. And Mark, this looks like a question for you. Yinho Ling is asking, Trump is tough on immigrants and has a very different approach compared to the social democrats in Europe, like Germany has taken a large number of immigrants in. Is Biden leaning more towards this kind of social democratic model in terms of immigration, do you think?
Yeah, from what we know, definitely. All these executive actions that Trump took in terms of immigration, the bans on certain countries, the visa issue that we discussed before, not just for journalists, but also for high skilled workers. I think it's going to go back to more or less the Obama policy here. I mean, the issue is not going away. The issue of immigration needs to be addressed. Look at the Dreamers, look at DACA. He said he will restore that immediately. So that's a big sign that he will definitely go the other way from Trump.
And here's a question for Chris McGreal. It says, how do you think the opioid epidemic may have affected people's reaction to COVID, the COVID pandemic, the addiction, the anger towards the pharmaceutical companies, et cetera? How did this shape attitudes towards mask wearing, social distancing, and even medical expertise?
Well, certainly it's true that amongst some people, there's a suspicion of corporate medicine. There's no doubt about that. Although I don't think that was the primary thing that fed into whether people wore masks or not, as we just discussed. But I do think that there is a greater suspicion in this part of the world than perhaps there used to be in the past about corporate entities and about their interests and about whether they, whether they should be trusted. And actually, I think it's a trick the Democrats have missed. I mean, it's quite revealing that, when Trump beat Hillary Clinton, he was seen as the man likely to stand up for ordinary people against big corporate interests, and that Hillary Clinton was seen as the person most likely to be representing those corporate interests. And I think the Democrats are still seen, actually, corporate Democrats in those terms in many ways. So I think there is that suspicion of corporate medicine and those companies. I don't know that it was an overwhelming factor, but I think we see all of these things, don't we, really, as part of a general kind of erosion of belief, confidence in systems. I think that's been happening in lots of different ways, including the government, including journalism, all of these things, and certainly that's part of it, yeah.
And one last interesting question here, which I'll see who wants to take this one, saying basically that, I hope this question doesn't sound offensive, but when someone says all lives matter versus Black lives matter, it seems like all lives matter says to some Black people that their lives don't. And they want someone to try to explain that. What's wrong with saying all lives matter? Mark, you've been there since 1994. How do you explain to someone not in the U.S. why saying all lives matter is offensive to Black people?
Well, of course, all lives matter. But to say that as a response to Black Lives Matter, it's like, and I've heard this before from other people, it's like going to an AIDS benefit and people say, but cancer kills too. Yes, but we have a specific problem here. We have a problem, and what Chris also pointed out, that George Floyd's death was on camera, but there are so many others that are not on camera that are still going on. I think the database of the Washington Post has like 1,000 cases a year So there is a specific problem here that we need to address and that Americans need to address. So when you say all lives matter, yeah, but Black lives matter in this context, of course. It's hard to explain, but it is offensive when you say that in that context.
Sure.
I'd just add, it's worth looking at who uses that phrase, all lives matter. It's not people who are really interested in doing something about the fact that the police kill so many Black people in this country. Disproportionately, African Americans are far more likely to be killed by the police than any other population. And again, just look at who's using it.
That's a good point. Look at who uses a phrase before you decide whether or not the phrase itself is offensive. Good, very good point. Before we wrap up here, we've got a couple of minutes left here. There's one question for Zhao Yinfeng, but I'm going to let you answer that privately because there's a student who says she's going to DC and she wants to know about your life, the life and culture in Washington. So I think she wants your restaurant recommendation. So I might get her email. And you can have a private conversation with her. She's moving to DC. She's interested. Oh, no, she's studying at GWU. So she said she's interested in talking to you. So I'm sure you. Well, she just said, no, that's not what I'm asking you, laughing out loud.
I would say come to New York.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Okay, Sheldon Zhang, you need to go to Brooklyn, Mark is saying. But I want to go around, I want to do a last round robin and ask you guys one last question each, the same question each. I want to ask you, when you go, for your audience back in who you're writing for or broadcasting for, just say, tell me one or two things that you know about America from living there that you wish they understood better. And let's start with you, Yan Zhang. What do you wish your Chinese audience understood about America that you get because you live there, but they don't quite understand?
Well, it's an interesting question. Let me try to think about it. I used to believe the president of the United States is strictly constrained by the judiciary system and the political system. So his power should be constrained rather than abused. That is what I learned from college. I studied political science in college. And now somehow I noticed that a president can really do whatever he wants to do. So if you look at how many executive orders he issued in the past 4 years, those sanctions bans, even though some of them were challenged, but they still create a lot of fear and anxiety and hatred in the society. Many of our readers are pro-democracy, liberal young people with a China or Hong Kong or Taiwan background. And they see the US as a lighthouse, as a beacon of democracy. But what I learned here is democracy is really something you need to constantly work on. And we have a lot of work to do, and we couldn't expect, we are still far away from the destination. Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say, yeah.
Sure, yeah, very good.
If I can build on that, yeah, I feel like this is a glass half full, half empty situation. And I certainly agree with what Yan just said, but I also heard another story from an American friend who used to be a Peace Corps volunteer in China. He was there during Trump's era, and he was surprised that Chinese people took it for granted that Trump is the most powerful man in the US and imagined that he could do whatever he wants. And my friend was trying to explain to Chinese people that the role of president is different in the US compared with the one in China. Trump could do a lot, but he is also constrained in many ways. And we've seen in the past 4 years, yes, he has changed America a lot and tainted America's image overseas. At the same time, American democracy is still at work. That's why people voted him out. So if I can say there's one thing I wish I had known before coming to the US, one is how diverse it is. Another one is how revolutionary it is. I'm still impressed by the mechanism in the US, how it can self-heal and how it can correct its own mistakes.
America self-corrects, and we're the world's first revolutionary country. Mark, what are you, I mean, you've been there a really long time, but they must still be constantly trying to explain something about America back to their Spiegel audience that they don't quite get. What is it? Well,
it goes with the same idea, what we just talked about. Germans believed that, you know, or believed before the last 4 years that the United States of America is the cradle of modern democracy. And we've seen that it's very brittle. And I'm not quite sure yet why this has held the system. Partly, I think, because Trump doesn't really know what he's doing. I feel like if we had somebody there who is much smarter about what he's doing, but would want to do the same things, I think we had a different, we could have a different result here. So I think the jury is still out on that. But I've struggled myself with my idea of America. I came here for all these reasons. I came here for the diversity. I moved here. I wanted to spend the rest of my life here. And for the first time in all these years, I thought, well, maybe it's time to go back to Germany. So I'll give it another try. I think from my travels here and from my reporting and from my friendships, there are many, many more good Americans than they're not, on both sides of the aisle. And we shouldn't get too distracted by, you know, some crazy people and some conspiracy theorists and some QAnon folks and think that's what Americans are. I think the majority of Americans are wonderful people, no matter what they think politically. I've always been, I've always felt welcome in every home, Republican or Democrat. And I think that's something that is still valid today.
Yeah, one of our audience members posted in that, you know, we can't look at people as monolithic. There are all kinds of people who voted for Trump, and they even met a young trans woman who voted for Trump, because, you know, there's always a danger of not seeing on both sides there are good people, like you mentioned. Chris, you've been there a very long time now and living in middle America, so you've learned some things that you're obviously always trying to let your audience know. What do you wish they understood better?
Well, I think it's picking up on the themes that, you know, the others have been discussing, but perhaps the element of it that most stands out for me now is actually, and this is quite shocking to say in some ways, but is how corrupt the American system is. I think American politics is deeply corrupted by corporate money, to the point that, as has been observed in the past by others, it borders on becoming an oligarchy in some aspects. I wouldn't want to overstate that. But you see the corruption of democracy through gerrymandering, through the loading of the Supreme Court, through the kind of, you know, we all learn as non-Americans that the American system is based on checks and balances, but actually they really aren't checks and balances. They're quite heavily loaded political die. That means that indeed the man that we're told is the most powerful man in the world isn't actually the most powerful man in the world, certainly not in domestic terms. And I'm sure, you know, Barack Obama would be able to explain that quite clearly. But it is true, he does wield enormous power. That is, I think, you know, governance is greatly influenced by forces that aren't really representative of Americans and how they vote and, you know, democratic interests. And they, I think, have fed into where we find ourselves today. People left behind economically, all of those issues. This isn't a recent phenomenon. It's been going on for decades.
Yeah. All great answers. My answer to my own question would have been, I wish people understood more the decentralized nature of American government and politics, especially with elections, how elections are not run by the federal government or even by states. It's actually counties and cities that run their own elections, and or the president can't order a mask order because he has to go through governors, he has to go through states, he has to go through counties sometimes, and cities that say, no, we're not going to enforce that order. So people don't understand, how come the president can't just order something? I want to thank all of our panelists here. Yin Zhang from Initium Media. If you read Chinese and you want to know what's going on, you have to read Initium. Zhao Yingfeng, BBC, broadcasting in both English and Chinese, correct? Thank you for being with us. Mark Pitzke from Der Spiegel. I'm sorry, I can't understand Der Spiegel because it's in German, but you have great covers. And Chris McGreal from The Guardian, which is in English, so we can read it. So, and you've been out there in the middle America, and you've got a book out on opioids, which everybody can find on Amazon. I want to thank you all for joining us, and I want to thank our audience members and all those who are going to be watching us on YouTube. And please pay attention to HKU Journalism on our YouTube site, where this recording will be posted, and we can see all of our past and future ones as well. And I want to extend an invitation for all of you panelists to please come and visit us in Hong Kong once the pandemic is over, once you get that jab, you're all vaccinated and the quarantines are lifted. We'd love to see you here in person. Again, thank you very much for joining us. I'm the only thing standing between you and cocktail hour. So I want to say again, we really enjoyed this. It's been fantastic for our students, fantastic for our audience here. So go enjoy a cocktail while I enjoy a coffee.
Thank you, Keith.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, and thank you everybody in the audience. Bye-bye.